for me.
Come on, open your mouth, death.
Death could not hold you down. You are the risen King.
Oh, how many believe that?
Seated in majesty.
Oh, come on, sing it.
You are the risen King.
Hallelujah. Come on, everybody, sing that.
Hallelujah. You have won the victory.
Static.
Hallelujah. Yes. Hallelujah.
You have won.
You have won it all for me. Death could not hold you down. 'Cause you are the risen King. Seated in majesty.
My God,
you are the risen King. Death could not hold you down. Death could not hold you down.
You are the risen King. Come on.
You are the risen King. You're seated in majesty.
Thank you, God.
Hallelujah.
My God,
you have done it all for me.
Somebody say hallelujah.
Hallelujah. You have won the victory.
Everybody say hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
You have done it all for me.
Death could not hold you down.
Somebody say, because you are the risen King. Where is he seated tonight?
Oh, yes, you are the risen King. That's why we sing hallelujah. Hallelujah. You have won the victory.
Thank you, God. Thank you, God.
Oh, yes. Hallelujah. Yes.
You have done it all for me. Oh, you may be seated.
Hallelujah. You have won the victory.
Anybody feel this worship tonight? I do. Anybody in here feel that worship tonight?
Hallelujah. Oh, you have done it all for me.
Oh, come on, come on, play it, play it.
Oh, hallelujah, hallelujah.
Oh, come on, you watching by internet.
You have won the victory.
Oh, yes. Hallelujah. You have done it all for me. My God, thank you, Jesus. Oh, I gotta say, hallelujah, yeah. Oh, you have won the victory, yes, you have. Oh, yes, hallelujah, yes. You have done it all for me. Somebody need to worship him right there. Oh, you're seated in majesty. Yes, you are. Yes, you are. Yes, you are. Oh, you're seated in majesty. Yes, you are. Yes, you are. Yes, you are. You're seated in majesty. Bibles, I have something that is pressing in my spirit tonight. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Went up stairs after working, and something just began to pound in my spirit, and I had to follow where the Lord was taking me. Those of you that are watching for the first time, we've been dealing with the power of understanding and having homeostasis. Thank you. There is something that particular that struck me in a way that I don't know that I had seen it in that fashion before. You can get it. But today I did. And I'm going to be coming from, it's in the wrong direction. That's why it pops out. It goes this way. Put it in that way. Mm-hmm. The book of Joshua, the 4th chapter, and the 9th through the 11th verse. Glad to see many of you out in the class tonight. And those of you that are watching by Facebook, tag somebody. I don't know. God's favor must be really sitting on this page, because I had not planned to keep going live like this, but God keeps directing me to do so. So apparently somebody that is watching is going to need this. When I'm looking at the homeostasis diagram, and possibly because we are on Wirecast now, I did this for the page. I felt led for Valentine to get a brand new computer and equipment so that I can go live on Facebook and you all not hear all the saints praising God and yelling. And I was seeing some of the posts, Pastor, where some of the people was posting saying, whoever that lady is that's praising God, she needs to shut up or get away from the camera. So I don't want nobody to be offended because they can't hear. So I made that investment because I love this page. I love the bumblebees on At Three With Me. I'm sorry, I have a just a love for them. And when I feel like it's time to feed them, I do. But as it relate to this class, this class has got a hook in me that I can't let go. And so I know God is doing something. But in looking at the homeostasis diagram and understanding that the word for the process of the homeostasis is to check, to make sure that you are balanced. And we're getting ready to speak on that today. Balance. Fabian, come and take a seat. Thank you. balanced. And in order for things to be properly balanced, it all has to sit in a certain place. It all has to sit in a certain place. If you believe that you can reach destiny being anywhere and doing anything, you are sadly mistaken. Destiny has a course that you must take. Destiny has a course that you must take. Destiny is carved out as a journey. And you got a lot of people in this hour that I'm learning don't know how to make the journey. It's not that people don't want to go to destiny, and it's not that people that don't want to reach their goals in prayer. They don't know how. They don't know how. And so I can go to California and never been before, and I can get on the highway and I cannot really pay attention to the map, and I can figure out how to get there. But it doesn't mean that I would get there in the right timing. I'll get there, but it would take me longer to get there because I don't know what I'm doing. Not only taking me longer to get there, but there's a passage that says not only would it take me a long time to get there, but you can also get there in a short amount of time. And you can celebrate the fact that I got to California, but you can't do that again. Because you lucked up on that. Because you didn't know where you were going. You just took a turn and ended up somewhere. And so in order for God to develop us into being masterclass type of intercessors, we have to know a direction all the time. If somebody needs deliverance, I got to know how to get you there every time. Not tonight the demon came out, and then tomorrow night I can't cast him out. I'm saying something right here. It may not be important to you right now, but it is. You have to know how to operate in victory all the time. You got to know the pattern to it. You got to know how to get there. You got to be able to look at situations and look at people and say, oh, you know what? I know how to get you there because I done been there several times. I done took the trip several times. And so now what we're dealing with as it relates to prayer is a lot of hype, but not a lot of solid direction. I'm not hearing nobody. I'm talking about direction that outside of your prayer partner, you can do it. You ain't got to call and say, well, let me go and get sister so-and-so because the demon acting up. You know how to break the spirit of bondage. Are y'all hearing this? But there is a key that I feel that is missing, so vital in the body of Christ. And as it relates to people of prayer. Joshua 4:9, I'm going to tell you about a couple experiences I've had so that you can understand that I know what I'm talking about. I've had the same experience. Joshua 4:9-11. And Joshua set up 12 stones in the midst of Jordan, in the place where the feet of the priests, which bear the ark of the covenant, stood. And they are there unto this day. For the priests which bear the ark stood in the midst of Jordan until everything was finished that the Lord commanded Joshua to speak unto the people, according to all that Moses commanded Joshua. And the people hasted and passed over. The word that I want us to pay attention to tonight that's going to gain some severe notoriety in your life is the word finished. The word finished. I want you to write that word down. The word finished. The word finished. Dr. Mano, why are we going to this? Because many people fail in prayer, fail at things in prayer, because they don't finish. They don't finish the work of prayer. They get caught in the middle, and they get caught in the sensationalism of prayer. I gotta really break this down tonight because I'm just experiencing some things and been seeing some things over the last couple of days. The hype of prayer. You're not in the finished, watch this. You're not in the finished work of praying something through until you have no more emotion about it. I just said something right there. Until you have no more emotion about it. Because a lot of us think that we are praying through because I feel it. You start praying about something and God give you an assignment. And you start praying about it and you start interceding about it. And you all hyped about it. And you just loving God and loving the fact that God done showed you what it is he wants you to accomplish in prayer. But then something happens to the intercessor. Something wears off. The passion wears off. And when the passion wears off, watch this. And fatigue set in. We begin to turn the prayer in another direction, and we sense in our own emotion that because I've become fatigued about something, now it means that the Lord is lifting this off of me. That is not what that means. When you become weary and fatigued in prayer and you become overwhelmed and tired, it is a time that you are going through a portal. You are going through an exit door. The Lord is now exiting you out of your emotions about prayer, and you are about to tap into the will of God. And this is where the enemy comes to attack every intercessor in the world, because when you become frustrated, you cannot finish. Tell somebody, say, I need to finish. You didn't really say that like you meant that. I said, touch somebody really seriously and said, you got to finish. You got to finish. spirit that I sense in the body of Christ. That everybody jump and they start stuff. But we're not finishers. And that's why the devil takes us. And he, and watch this, and he knocks us around. Because we don't have the power to finish. I'm not hearing y'all talk to me. No. The Bible said that watch this. When Jesus was going through the process, listen, it wasn't enough for everybody to glorify and the North Star to show up and three wise men bearing gifts going finding, you know, where Jesus was born, and all the heavens are celebrating the fact that the Savior has come into the world. That wasn't good enough. He came into the world to finish. I said something right there. He didn't come into the world to just be praised. He didn't come into the world just to be glorified. He came into the world to be the Savior of the world. And he can't get halfway there. Come on, somebody. He fell with the cross, but he had to finish. He was whipped, but he had to finish. Why? Because of what was connected to his finishing. Oh, my God. We think what we're doing is about us. It's not about us. I'm going to say it again. It's not about us. Everything that God has called you to do, it's not about you. You are the least part of it. I'm not hearing y'all. You are the least part of it. When God gives you an assignment, it is not about you. But if you don't finish, you don't know the legacy. You don't know, oh y'all, you don't know the length and the depth of where your finishing is going to reach. Come on, somebody. There's going to be people lost because you didn't finish. There's going to be people that die in the hospital because you didn't finish. Oh my God, I can't get nobody to say nothing right there. Somebody say, you got to finish this thing. I'm not hearing y'all. You got to finish. You got to finish. You got to finish. In other words, you got to, Lord Jesus, I heard you right there. He said, you got to go back and pick up some assignments that I gave you, that you call yourself talking about. That lifted off of me. No, it didn't lift off of you. That person is still lost because you didn't finish. That person is still a crackhead because you haven't finished. Who am I talking to tonight? Here, watch this. Here Joshua is. Watch this. Here Joshua is. It's time to go to Canaan. It's time to go to the promise. And God said this. If I take y'all the easy way. Good Lord have mercy. That right there will preach right there. If I take you the easy way. Y'all gonna do this man just like y'all did Moses. Y'all gonna keep forgetting where I brought you from. If I take you the easy way. You're gonna give me some praise for a little while. But you're not gonna remember what I brought you through. Y'all ain't saying nothing. So I'm going to take you through the Jordan River. And watch the command that he gives to Joshua. And that's what we are in this room tonight. That's who you are that's watching tonight. You're like Joshua. He says to them, I'm going to stand you up. And I'm going to make you keep speaking a word to the people while they cross Jordan. But what if he had got tired? Oh, I'm not hearing y'all. What if he had got tired and not finished? I'm not hearing y'all. Moses started getting tired. But God sent somebody to hold up his arms because his finishing was connected to us right now. Oh, I'm not hearing y'all talk to me. Moses never met us. Y'all ain't saying that. He never knew that 2018 was coming. But in his loins, in his obedience to finish, we were locked up in that deliverance. Oh, God. Who am I talking to tonight? Who am I talking to tonight? Who am I talking to tonight? No, we getting high in the middle. We get high in the middle. He talking to somebody tonight. We get high. No, I'm going to tell you some stories in a minute. We get high in the middle. In the center of it. But that scripture said, Joshua could not stop until even the most feeble person was across Jordan. Y'all ain't saying that. Oh God. His mouth was responsible for everybody. Oh, you don't hear what I'm saying. Well, I did. You know, I think it's hard that God called me to pray for these two people. This man's mouth was responsible for millions of people coming to their deliverance. I'm not hearing you. You don't have time to say, I'm tired. You don't have a right to say, I'm tired. You don't have a right, nor do you have permission to say, I quit. You don't want to believe this, but millions of people are tied into your finishing. Okay, I'm not getting nobody to talk to me right there. Because y'all say, well, my name ain't Juanita Bynum, and my name ain't Lady Board, and my name ain't Pastor, and I'm not Dr. Soraya, and I ain't got no title. I'm not hearing y'all talk to me. But the Bible said in the book of Deuteronomy that the Spirit of the Lord came upon a man, and the man went into the city and changed that city. I'm not hearing y'all. It's your responsibility. Millions of people are sitting in your loins. I'm not hearing y'all. Why are you talking about, I can't finish? Oh God, let me just say this. Who am I talking to? Who am I talking to? You go to wash your car and you half wash it. I ain't getting nobody to say nothing right there. I can't get nobody to talk to me right there. Well, that ain't important. It ain't important that I didn't finish washing my car. It ain't important that I half vacuum it. I'm like, oh God. Pastor, I'm just coming down the lane right now. I'm coming down the lane right now. I was in this building today and I was straightening up chairs. And I knew I started getting on everybody's nerve. I was like, that ain't lined up. And that ain't like that. Well, I wish she stopped. And I wish she did. No. And I can see some of them out of my peripheral vision rolling their eyes. Because what you don't understand is this. The reason why we have a building right here is because Pastor Boyd finished. The reason why we are sitting in this building because of Pastor Boyd finished. And the reason why there is somebody else that's coming after Juanita Bynum, after Pastor Boyd, after Lady Boyd, because we must finish. I'm not hearing y'all. I'm not hearing y'all. How you line up chairs determine whether or not you will finish. Sit down, y'all. God, I can't get nobody to talk to me. How you sweep the floor determines where you going. And some of y'all ain't going far. I'm not hearing. The way you hang plastic determines whether or not. I'm not hearing y'all. Who am I talking to? Who am I talking to? The way you play the piano, all of the energy that you put in spending time with God on the assignment that God has given you. If God has called you to preach, sit yourself down and study. If God has called you to be a musician, sit yourself down and practice. Why? Because you must finish. Oh God. Oh God. Oh God, I can't get nobody to say nothing. I can't get nobody to say nothing. I can't get nobody to say nothing up in here. Good Lord have mercy. Who is God talking to? He said he spread it out the heavens. He said he spread it out the heavens in the book of Genesis. It said he spread it out the heavens and the earth and he finished it. Well then where would you be standing if God hadn't finished the earth? No, because you think it's all about being spiritual. Where would you finish? Because guess what? God was spiritual, but why did he make something natural? And what if he had a half made it? What part of the earth would you be standing on today? Oh God, who am I talking to up in here today? Who am I talking to today? My God, I feel this tonight. My God, I feel this tonight. Well, that ain't got nothing to do with my ministry because the Lord called me. The Lord called me to Africa. The Lord called me to go to Africa. What do I look like being in here telling this boy to take the cords down right? Come on, he called me to go to Africa. No, because taping down the cords indicates that I don't want to trip over nothing. I'm not hearing y'all. Come on, no, you don't think it's connected to nothing. But when you watch the movie Karate Kid, it's wash on, wash off. Because a lot of you all want to finish your course in the spirit. But God judges how you do things in the natural. And that determines where he can take you spiritually. Why I can't get nobody to say nothing right there? Why can't get nobody to say nothing right there? You don't finish nothing. You don't finish nothing. Somebody said, go over there and sweep the dining room across the hall. You go over there and crumbs are still. And you off talking to somebody. Talk about, I was going to get back to it. People don't know that that's a spirit. The spirit of destruction is a spirit. Because the devil is trying to birth something in you that's called an unfinished work. I'm not hearing. Do you not know that God is still working on you? Do you not know? I'm not hearing y'all. Do you not know that God is still finishing a work in you? I'm not hearing y'all. And the way you have to do things is a determination of God's ability and his accessibility in you. When you look at a person that can't never finish nothing, you give them the due, it's because they are interrupting God as well.
Oh, God.
I can't get nobody to talk to me right there. I can't get nobody to say nothing right there. No, I can tell God is being interrupted in your life. You can't finish dishes. God is being interrupted in your life. Because now you're walking under a spirit of not being finished. And that's why when you are under the anointing, understanding that God wants me to walk in a finished work, because I'm walking in his promise and I'm walking in what he said that I would end up being, that he would perfect those things in Psalms 138. He would perfect those things which concerns me. I'm like, if I'm truly walking in that and I'm allowing God to perfect those things in me, my attitude and everything that I do, I would do it like a finisher. I just said something right there. I will sweep like a finisher. I will paint like a finisher. I will play the music like a finisher. I'm not hearing y'all. Can't get nobody to talk to me right there. Can't get nobody to talk to me right there, mother. I can't. Move these chairs over here. They move three chairs. They go to talk about something else. Then I see you back there picking up a broom. I didn't tell you to pick the broom up. I said move these three chairs. You come back there to move the three chairs and they half crooked. You got to come back and say, that's not straight. And then to my surprise, you have people looking at you like, what you mean it ain't straight? Because crooked is all right in their life. Because crooked is all right in their spirit. I'm not hearing y'all. Half doing something is all right to people. Because half doing it is all right to your spirit. That's the way your spirit is. That's the way you live. I'm not hearing y'all. It's a shame that we do the most speaking in tongues rather than any generation I know. But we are the most unintegral people I have ever met. We have no integrity about nothing that we say. We say one thing and do another. I'm not hearing. We start doing something and do something else. I'm not hearing y'all. And what do we got? A little bit of everything and a finishing product of nothing. I hear nobody talk to me. I can't get nobody to say nothing. I can't get nobody to say nothing. And then mother gathers, we look and get mad at other people. When we see God blessing people, when we see God opening doors, we looking on TV, all that stuff, the Oscars and all of that, saying, well, you know what, that's the same. I just wish that was me. That person didn't get there because they lucked up. They got there because they was dedicated. They finished studying the script. Don't get it twisted, because we walk around in this illusion like everything that people do successful, it just pop up and happen. No, that's dedication. And the dedication comes from somebody praying, whether to the devil or God, and they ask God, let me be a finisher. Yeah. What am I trying to say? What am I trying to say here? Meryl Streep won another Oscar. She don't profess to know Jesus. She don't profess to have the Holy Ghost. But when your spirit is all compiled of an anointing to be a finisher, you can finish a work for the devil. And let me tell you what's sad about it. What's sad about it, Mother Gabbard, Lady Boy, is that we got people now. We're not a finisher to neither one. We cannot testify of a perfected work for the devil. And we can't testify of a perfected work for God. So guess what's happening, Mr. Cummings? It's a lot of spit in here. Because he said, I would that you be hot or cold. There's a lot of spit on the floor in here. Because a lot of people's gifts and talents and all of that is being spewed out of the mouth of God. He said, because I can't use you. I'm not hearing nobody talk to me. I can't use you because you're neither hot, you're neither cold. Who am I talking to? You don't finish sweeping. You don't finish mopping. You don't finish nothing. You don't finish washing your clothes. You don't finish cleaning up your room. I'm not hearing nobody talk to me. You don't finish paying your bills. You don't finish nothing. You just walk around and everything is half done. But now we want to sit over here and tell God, I'm waiting on you to finish. And God is telling me to tell you, I'm waiting on you to finish too. Can't get nobody talk to me right there. Can't get nobody say nothing right there. Lord, I want to be used by you. You can't be. God, I want you to take me up in the third dimension. Why? So you can die? If I start you to travel, you won't even finish the journey. Because finishing ain't in you. I'm not hearing nobody talk to me. You will never get to the third dimension because finishing is not in you. Navigating in that realm, you'll never get there because finishing is not in you. Is anybody receiving this besides me? Is anybody receiving this besides me? Somebody asked me one time, oh my God, well, you just got so much tenacity and it's like you got so much drive and you won't stop. I've never seen anybody like that. It just won't stop. Well, what is it that make you keep going? Because I know, watch this, because I know that unmerited to me, my father loaned me his last name. And that last name has a legacy attached to it. I'm not hearing y'all. And I knew that I had to finish whatever this trial was for everybody that's coming behind me with the last name Bynum. I'm not hearing y'all. So listen, if I can do that for the last name Bynum, I should be able to do that for the last name Jesus. I'm not hearing y'all talk back to me. When you don't know that a legacy is attached to what God is doing in your life, then you don't know the importance of finishing. Can I just testify? Can I just testify? The commentary said this, that when God decided to make Joshua take the people over Jordan to Canaan, watch this, they had to go to their freedom through the enemy's camp. Okay. Because we want to go to victory on a smooth bed of ease. They had to go to Canaan through the enemy's camp with their wives, their children, their grandmamas, their granddaddies. I'm not getting nobody to say nothing. I'm not getting nobody to say nothing right there. So what was God saying? You want Canaan, but I got to see, do you really want Canaan? Because do you want Canaan bad enough to go to Canaan through the enemy's camp? In other words, will you finish even though you got to walk through hell to get there? I'm not hearing nobody talk to me right there. Will you finish even though there's a possibility that you're going to be confronted by many enemies? Will you still finish? Will you still finish when your head hurts and your back hurts and your feet hurt? I'm not hearing y'all. Will you still finish when you don't feel good, when you're depressed, when you get attacked by the devil? It's finishing in you. I can't get nobody to talk tonight. I can't get nobody to talk tonight. Y'all not talking back. Y'all not talking back. I just kept hearing them say, finish. 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 Oh God. I just kept hitting the Lord and say, finish. Finish. And see, behind the curtain, you know, we building the new set. We building the new set. I'm finna say something. I'm building a new set for television. Getting ready to go on Impact Network twice a day, Monday through Friday, 3 p.m., 3 a.m. Watch this. My focus at first was the set. It was a set. Everything was a set. It was a set. And then God said to me, well, what are you going to do with what's surrounded by the set? How are you going to ignore what's around you and just be focused on what you want to do? I'm not here. Because see, most of us think we want to be intercessors, but you don't, because you're selfish. Because you think intercession is about what you're going to get. Sometimes you ain't going to get nothing for it. Sometimes you got to lose something. Sometimes you're going to have to share what you got. I'm not here. I'm not hearing y'all talk to me. Sometimes you're going to have to let God change the image of what you're trying to do in order for us to finish. I'm not here. I'm a part of a church that need to finish. I'm not hearing y'all. Who am I preaching to? It's not just about the set. I am joined to a ministry that's got to finish.
Sit down for a second. Let me show you something.
So the walls is a part of my finish. The ceiling is a part of my finish.
Yes.
Cords being taken down is a part of my finish. I'm not hearing nobody talk to me. I ain't hearing nobody talk to me. Chairs being organized is a part of the finish. Walls being painted right is a part of the finish. Curtains being put up right is a part of the finish. I'm not hearing y'all. The ceiling, no, I don't play an instrument over there, but the way they lined up is a part of my finish. I'm not hearing y'all. Because guess what? When you walked in the building, you saw something organized, looking like it's about to finish. Don't nobody want to be a part of nothing that's falling apart. They don't want to be a part of you and you always falling apart. They don't want to be a part of you and you always complaining. Because guess what? Yes, the journey is going to be hell. Oh my God. Do you think people win the Olympics because somebody liked them? Do you think they win it for nothing? No, that's 4 years every single day. Monday through Sunday, I'm not hearing y'all. Every single morning, 8 to 16 hours a day, just to have one moment on the ice. I'm not hearing y'all. Who am I talking to? Do you think people win championships because they fine and got muscles? No, that's hours and hours and hours and hours of practicing, not how to win, but how to finish. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Like the little rookie from Alabama. A rookie on the team. Ain't never played in the championship. But apparently, he was preparing himself for a moment. Oh, come on here, somebody. God is about to give you a moment. I'm not hearing you. If you ain't here tonight, God is telling you it's time to prepare. Because God is about to set you up for a moment. But you got to be ready. I'm not hearing y'all. Touch your neighbor and say, you got to finish. Don't even start washing your car if you ain't going to finish it. I didn't hear nobody say nothing. I ain't hear nobody say nothing. Don't even start cleaning out your closet if you ain't going to finish. I'm talking to somebody right now. The Holy Ghost said, I don't know about y'all, but that's such a revelation in my spirit. Maybe I'm just happy by myself. You don't hear me. Don't even start washing the dishes if you ain't going to finish. Because I want the Holy Ghost to let that thing ring in your spirit. Don't even start reading a book if you ain't going to finish it. Because the enemy is trying to make sure that you never birth out the spirit to finish. That's what his job is. His job is to keep on letting you start stuff. And I'm allowing you not to finish. work on. He don't owe you a paycheck. I'm not hearing nobody talk to me right there. He ain't got to do nothing for you. Lord, when you gonna bless me? When you finish up. Lord, when you gonna work it out for me? When you finish something. I'm not hearing nobody. Because see, this ain't gonna set well with black people. I ain't getting nobody to talk to me. This ain't gonna set well. Because we're some of the most talented, unfinishing people I know. That's the problem. We know how to do everything. That's the problem. We know how to start at 29 years old and become a tennis champion. I'm not hearing y'all talk to me. We know how to start in our 30s and become a basketball champion and a shot put shooter. Who am I talking to? Because the talent is in our genes. And sometimes talent becomes a danger. Because talent says, I don't have to work no more. I don't have to put in time. Talent says, I do enough to get recognized, but I have not perfected my game. Operating under the spirit of Pisgah. You know what that means? The spirit of Pisgah is the spirit of almost. I almost, Mother Gavis. Oh my God. I almost won. I almost went to the championship. Y'all ain't saying nothing. I almost finished college. You under the spirit of Pisgah. Well, God, I know you gave. Here it is. I know you gave it to me, but the enemy is busy. The enemy was busy when they was walking through Jordan. I'm not hearing y'all talk to me. The enemy was busy when millions of people was walking on enemy territory. I'm not hearing y'all. But when they made a decision that we go into the finish, then God had to back the enemy up. And if you wondered why, the devil won't leave you alone, because God already see you ain't going to finish what he told you to do. But when the Lord see that there's a spirit in you that says, I'm going to finish what God gave me, he will back the devil up. Just like he backed up the walls of the Red Sea. Just like he parted the Jordan. You don't hear me? Who am I talking to? God will defend what he has called you to do when he sees that you are going to finish. I remember, watch this, I gotta tell you the story. When Bobby Christina drowned, she drowned. They said she wasn't gonna live. And everybody was saying she's not gonna live. And they were saying in a matter of days she's gonna be gone. And the Lord woke me up one night and said, I'm giving you this assignment. And I was like, okay, well, Lord, you want me to pray? And so I prayed a little bit. You know, I prayed, oh, God, you know, if it be your will. I prayed that scary intercessor's prayer. When we're not bold enough to have divine information, then we go to the Lord if it be your will, because we don't know his way anyway. So whichever way it turn out, we didn't say that I said that. And so I was in revival in Chicago, and the Lord said to me, I don't want you to leave out of here. I don't want you to go to the hotel. I want you to stay in this church. I want you to hear this. I stayed in the church, and I prayed. And then one night, the spirit of her deliverance came on me, Mother Gavis. And God said, I said, pray. So I asked the Lord, I said, what is your will, Lord? And I began to lay before him. I said, what is your will? And he took me to the scripture where the man came and found Jesus. And while he was talking to Jesus, the people was telling him, your daughter is dead. And the scripture said, and ignoring them, Jesus heard them, but he ignored them. And he assured the man that his daughter was going to be all right. And so the Holy Ghost said to me, ignore what you are hearing. I said, I'm sending you on an assignment. So he said, get the prayer cloth, the shroud of Jesus, put her name on it. And every night, I want you to lay on this pulpit, and I want you to cover your face in it. And so I was still struggling, saying, okay, God, and I was praying, and God would just take me up, and I would just pray. But I still didn't have information. I was just praying. praying. Still didn't know exactly what God was going to do. And one night the Lord visited me and he said, in that church, he said, when I tell you this is an assignment, I'm going to tell you what's wrong with her. But I'm going to tell you this, she is going to open her eyes. And I said, yes, Lord. I said, yes, Lord. He said, I want her in full recovery. I said, yes, Lord. I left the revival and came home. When I got home, Mother Gathers, the Holy Ghost arrested me in my house. I couldn't eat nothing. He said, put on all white. Every single day, the Lord was giving me something different. He was telling me, write this, write that. This is what's wrong with her brain. This is what's wrong with her. No, bind this up. I need you to go in and repair this. I was in prayer in another dimension. I could not eat. I could not sleep. It was past 13 days and I couldn't. When I would go to sleep, the Lord would take my spirit up and I would end up in her hospital room. The next thing I knew, the doctors would be saying, this is wrong and that is wrong. And I had to start showing. Somebody said, this is what God told me. He arrested me. Alicia was there. He arrested me. I couldn't hardly move. I would walk through my house and all of a sudden, whatever it was she was feeling that day, I had convulsions. I had times when I was on the couch and I would go into shakes and my eyes would roll back in my head. And the Lord said, her brain is hemorrhaging. I want you to pray in your spirit. He said, this is your assignment. When she opened up her eyes, I said to some friends of mine, I said, God said, she's going to open up her eyes. He kept navigating, giving me how to pray, giving me what to pray. They said, she's not going to make it through this day. God said, yes, she is. He said, I've given you this assignment. But in the middle, I got weary. I got tired. I was weak. I didn't like what I felt. It's a feeling that when you are in divine obedience, he takes you up in a realm and you're not earthly. I couldn't feel myself. I was on an assignment and I said, God, I can't take it no more. After 13 days, after 21 days, Mother Gathers, going on 30 days, I was losing weight like crazy. I was like a drunk woman in my house. I couldn't go outside. I couldn't change out of that robe. It was like he had me held hostage. And the night that I said, God, I can't do this no more. This is too hard. I can't do it. I can't do it. And I put my clothes on and went outside. And a couple of weeks later, she died. And God said to me, you failed me. I gave you this assignment and you got tired and you got weary. But what I want you to understand, if you're going to get to power, you're going to have to suffer in your body for other people's deliverance. I'm not hearing y'all talk back to me. That day, he said to me, you better not ever not finish what I gave you. Because a person's life depends on you finishing. I'm not hearing nobody talk to me. No, I can admit that failure. I'm not hearing y'all. I can admit that failure. I can admit that one. He said, I said, I'm not calling people in this hour to be no touch your neighbor and and oh Jesus and oh God and do it right now. No. I'm calling some people to operate in a spirit where your tongues is in your heart. And it's not what's coming out your mouth, but it's what your spirit have the power to control. I'm not hearing y'all talk to me because the Lord just dropped something on me. And though I got to go to work, my spirit is going to finish this. I'm not hearing y'all talk to me. Though I got to go to church, my spirit going to finish this. How do you know that the Lord is gnawing at you because you can't let it go? Where is the class at? Because y'all sitting there looking at me like what is Dr. Bynum talking about? Come on, that's why it's a master class. How many people in here that you can't let it go? And all of a sudden you will let something go. And 2 years later, it'll pop up again in your spirit. You can't let it go because he is requiring that you finish that. So then my test came again. Y'all sit down, I got to tell you this. Somebody say, I got to finish.
Got to finish. Got to.
And hear nobody talk to me. Y'all ain't said, I said, tell your neighbor, I got to finish. Tell your neighbor again, I got to finish. So one night I'm walking out the church. I'm giving you these examples. when God puts something in your spirit, and the Lord has had Dr. Johnson in my spirit for some years now, and I would pray for her, and so I just went on this little whatever, and all of what I was doing, and I wasn't praying for her like I used to pray for her, and so I'm coming out of church, and that thing came up in my spirit again. And so I was like, you know, I'm just going to be praying for Dr. Johnson. Every now and then people say, well, she not feeling well. I said, well, I'm going to be praying for her. One day I was on my way out the church doing Bring Back the Glory. And I was walking out the church. I wasn't thinking about Dr. Johnson. I was going to pass her like I always do. And that time when I passed by her, the Holy Ghost caught me up. And out of my gut, the pit of my stomach, I don't even know where it came from. It's like this sound, I just went, no! And I went home and I could hear that howl in my spirit. And it wasn't long after that the devil tried to take her life. But intercession had already told the enemy, no, I'm not hearing y'all. Because God is intending for me to finish. Who am I talking to? I can't stop praying for Dr. Johnson until she is running. I can't stop praying for Dr. Johnson. She is standing on her feet, running around the church. Who am I talking to? And so you wonder, well, why is Bookie still in jail? Well, why is Jimmy still on drugs? Am I hearing y'all? Well, why am I still having problems? Why is my family going through changes? Why is my marriage not working out? Because he gives a finish to the finishers. I'm not hearing y'all. I'm not hearing y'all. Okay, ask yourself, what has the Lord given me to do that I didn't finish? Then don't require a finish if you don't surrender a finish. I'm not hearing y'all. You know why? Can I give you a secret? Because somebody, the Lord has dropped you in somebody's spirit. And they got the assignment of Geneva Commons. And they can't let it go. Watch this. And every now and then, they start praying for you real hard. Do you know why they pray for you real hard? Because every now and then, you start praying for Erica real hard. And so the Lord's saying, oh, you back on the journey now? So let me get the people back on the journey that I got on the journey for you. Oh, you on the journey for Erica? Okay, now I can put somebody on the journey for you. Oh, you ain't on the journey for Erica? Then I can let the person that I called to be on the journey for you. They can go somewhere and relax, because I'm talking about a finish work that's a thread. Finish is a thread that runs through the life of everybody. Finish is a thread that runs through the life of everybody. I'm going to say it again. Finish is a thread that runs through the life of everybody. If you're not finishing, they not finishing. If they not finishing, you're not finishing. I'm not giving. Whoever God has called to pray for you and pray for your family. When you stop praying, you break the rope. I'm not hearing you. You break the thread. I'm not hearing you. Finish can't get to your house because you broke the thread when you stop finishing. Why can't get nobody to say nothing right there? Why can't get nobody to say that right there? Oh, because you thought you could pray when you felt like it. Now, I see some people writing, but you can. I'm going to let you have that one. I'm going to let you pretend like you're writing some notes. Because you know that just busts you upside your head. So I'm going to give y'all that minute. Go on, pretend like you're writing. I'm not hearing y'all. So my test came around again for the third dimension thing. So I was asked to preach my cousin's funeral. And I said, okay, they want me to preach her funeral. She's one of my favorite cousins. So I'm all emotional and everything. God said, okay, do all your crying right now because you got to preach the funeral. Get to the church. The Lord used me. Family members got saved. It was just a blowout in the Holy Ghost. So I had a prayer shawl, tradition of my family, to cover them with prayer shawls when they go. Providing they love the Lord. We ain't covering no demon. Live for the devil. You just going to your devilly father. We ain't going to cover that prayer. So I had a prayer shawl for her. And so you cut one of the corners off because you don't need the authority of God anymore. So my dissertation is on, what is this? Is it Jewish or is it Jesus? Talking about the prayer shawl. So I had my prayer shawl in the same bag. So when, I'm going to tell you how all things work together for the good. A lot of stuff that you all thinking, the devil is messing it up. It ain't the devil, it's God. It's God intercepting for a greater purpose. So I just felt the wind of the Holy Ghost for somebody that's watching. You think it'd be the devil, it don't be the devil. It's God said I got a greater purpose for this. So Pastor, when the funeral was about to be over, of course, I'm the person that put the pressure on the body. And then they close it down. So I stepped up to cover the body. And I told him, give me my pressure. And the Holy Ghost said to me, leave out of here now. Oh, wow. So you know, because I'm in a class of obedience, I don't be talking about, ain't. I just turned around and said to my sister, I said, God just told me to leave out of here. She said, you're not going to cover? I said, you cover the body. Yes. I said, God told me to leave out. So I left out and I'm sitting in the back room of the church waiting for them to get through viewing the body. So they come back in the back and my sister came back there and I said, so what are they doing? She said, everybody's really crying. Either they taking it hard. And I said, okay. I said, well, do me a favor because I'm a little chilly in here. I said, go get my press shawl. She said, okay. She went back and got my bag and she brought it to me. So when she opened it up, I said, wait a minute. This ain't the white press shawl. She said, what? You have to know Pastor Kathy to know how funny she is. She said, what? I said, you put the wrong press shawl on her. You put my press shawl on her. She said, oh my God. I said, that's okay. When we get to the burial tomorrow, I'll get it. I'll get it back then. She said, Nita, it ain't gonna be no burial. I said, what do you mean? She said, they gonna cremate her. I said, no. Ho. We don't cremate people. We don't burn up people. I mean, okay, I gotta help somebody right there. Ash to ashes, dust to dust. When Jesus come back for you, he gonna gather all your body parts. Where they at? What body? It's gonna be raised. Okay. Ashes? No, the saints don't see fire. We don't burn. Well, we didn't have no money. We'll just go out there and lay them in the park and let the city fire them, but we ain't burning them nobody. We ain't seeing no fire now, unless you hellbound or something. So I called Nana and I said, wait a minute. We can't do that. Because, you know, we the cousins left. Almost everybody's gone. She said, Nita, I tried to tell them, but they were saying that they didn't hardly have no money, and they putting her ashes in necklaces and stuff. I said, wait. That can't happen. So when you're in a family like mine, and I'm going to leave that alone, you don't just go to your family talking about, I think y'all wrong. They will cuss you out from here to Honolulu. So I said, God, what in the world? So the Lord kept dealing with me. He kept dealing with me. And I couldn't shake that thing. And so finally the next day, he said, call her daughter and tell her and give her the scripture. So I picked up the phone and I was pacing the floor. Miss Carmen, I was like, God help me. Because Angel is like almost a general in the army. She is like a CW5, got the highest security clearance. You can't get no high. Been in the army for almost 30 years and I'm going to tell her something about her mama. No. I was like, oh, I just got, hey, cuz, how you doing? Okay, well, I'm just going to tell you what the Lord said. And I just read the scripture. And so she said, Nita, what I'm going to do? And that was my first relief. I was like, okay. She said, what I'm going to do? I said, well, we got to call the people, the cremation place. And so we started trying to call and couldn't get no answer. Nobody answered. I said, well, I'll try in the morning. Well, I get home. And I lay down to go to sleep. And here comes that Bobby Christina thing. I said, no. You have to be a person that operate in that because you know when that presence is coming and you're going, wait. And listen, my insides just started transforming. And all of a sudden, I just felt that thing. I stood up to go to the bathroom, Pastor, and literally, people, it felt as if my body came up out of me and my feet was on my shoulders. And I was balancing myself and I was walking around in a stupor. I promise you, Alicia could tell you I'm telling the truth. When I get up to go to the bathroom, I had to hold on to the walls. And my spirit was in tongues that I had never heard before. And I'm like, God, what? He said, I need you to go up in the spirit realm and hold this body. He said, because it hasn't happened yet. And I'm like, well, wait a minute, because everybody told me that by law in Chicago, when you deliver a body to the crematory, they can only keep it for 24 hours. They didn't have it for 48 hours, and they have to cremate the body within 24 hours. And God said, no, they haven't done it yet, but I need you to hold this body in the spirit. And I was like, God, and I was walking around, and I went to the bathroom, and I started throwing up. And when I got through throwing up, my spirit was still speaking in these tongues. And when I would lay down, it felt like I would lay down and my whole body was pulling my head down deep into the couch. And I was like, God, I can't take no more. And it was 2 days of this. By the third day, the Holy Ghost said to me, I'll never forget, it was 1 o'clock in the afternoon. He said, call the crematory. And so I told my cousin, I said, the Holy Ghost said, call right now. She said, well, I said, hush and call right now. God said, call right now. We called the place and the man said, no, she already gone. He said, you know what? I'm just so sorry. He said, but it was a madhouse in here. And I said, mm-mm. I said, but the spirit has still got me. I'm not back in my body yet. I know that it's not done yet. She said, well, what you want me to do? I said, call him back again. She called him back again. And he said, wait a minute. Ma'am, I'm telling you, everybody is gone. He said, all the bodies came in. I called the funeral home. I said, you got to call this man. You got to call this man. And he said, well, Miss Bynum, I got a funeral to do. So it wasn't until later on that afternoon when he called the man, Pastor. The man said, when he saw the number, he said, you know what? That's the funeral home. I got this body because the day that they brought her body in here, 16 bodies ended up in here and her casket got pushed all the way down the hallway. And he said, I'm getting ready to put her in right now and I'm going to tell him she already going. I'm going to send you the ashes. He said, but something told me to pick up the phone. When he picked up the phone, Dr. Johnson, her body was moving toward the crematory and the funeral man said, stop. They want that body back. And he called me. He said, y'all must be some praying people. Because in all the years of me doing this, I've never done this before. But why did it happen? Why did we get her body back? Because God is looking for a finisher. Somebody that can finish. A finisher. Now, we the craziest family in Chicago. We have to have 2 funerals. We had to have 2 funerals. I'm not hearing y'all. We had to get a body back and have another funeral and walk a body out there and bury a body. And that's why when they asked me to commit the body, when they hit the thing, I broke down. I wasn't crying just because my cousin was gone. I was crying because a finished work was going in the grave. You don't hear me. Some of the most difficult things in the world that you think right now that God can work out, if he can find a finisher, he'll take you up in a realm to bring divine reversal to it. I'm not hearing nobody talk to me. I can't get nobody here to say that right now. Because see, we walking around here acting like God is a man. We walking around here acting like it's so hard. It ain't nothing too hard for God. He said the problem is I can't find nobody to process the whole thing through. Come on, somebody. It's a lot of people that ain't got to die. It's a lot of people that need to come out of jail right now. But I can't find a finisher. I'm not here. It's a lot of people that need to have their houses given back to them. But I can't find no finisher. Who am I talking to? It's a lot of people that's got incurable diseases. And the doctor said they're going to die. But I'm here you to tell somebody that's watching tonight that they don't have to die. It's a lot of people out there that's got kidney failure and liver failure and need a new heart transplant and need a lung transplant, but nothing is too hard for God. He's still doing miracles, but I can't do it in this realm. I gotta do it in that realm, and that realm requires a finisher. I can't get nobody to say nothing. Where y'all at, Master Class? Where y'all at? You want to pray a little $2 prayer?
Yeah.
Father God, in the name of Jesus, I'm just asking you, God, to just fix it. And this is my, hold on, because I got to kill something right here. And this is my positive confession. This is my positive confession. Speak positive.
Right. Yeah. Come on now.
What you gonna do with the devil that's speaking negative? Speak just speak positive. No. Yeah. That ain't it, people. That's not it. He's looking for the person. Watch this. You can speak all you want to. You can speak with your mouth while your insides is running. That was a word right there. You can confess all you want to when your insides is running like a chicken. I'm looking for somebody that know how to stand. I'm looking for somebody that know how to square the devil off. I can't get nobody talking. I can't get nobody. I'm looking for somebody to tell the enemy I'm not going to stop. And somebody just say, well, what if God don't do it? Well, you know what? He gonna have my ass on the table. I'm not hearing y'all. Well, what if he gonna do it? He gonna have my ass on the table. Put an ass on the table. You ain't even got an ass on the table. You ain't even asked the Lord for their healing. You haven't even asked the Lord for a miracle. How do you know God won't do it? Where is your ass? I'm not hearing y'all. Y'all off a quiet tonight. You ain't even got an ass on the table. I'm not taking my ass off the table. I'm not taking my ass off the table. I'ma square the devil off. I'm not taking my ass off the table. Y'all ain't saying that. When they said she really sick, I'm not gonna take my ass off the table. Who am I preaching to? Well, I ain't got no job yet. I'm not gonna take my ass off the table. Well, you know what? That position is coming up, and I don't know if I'm not gonna take my ass off the table. I'm not hearing y'all. Because as soon as you see it going one way, you start running. No, keep your, touch your neighbor and say, keep your ass on the table. I'm going to ask anyone. Who am I talking to? Who am I talking to? I'm going to ask anyway. I'm bold enough to ask anyway. Who would I just help right there? God, I want you to give this person a new kidney. Okay, I'm not getting it. I gotta stop because y'all trying to be church people tonight, and I ain't got time for church people. God, I want this person to have a new kidney in the name of Jesus. I speak it right now that you start developing it right now. I'm not hearing nobody talk to me right now. Hey, my God, you know why? Because you gotta be bold enough to ask. You gotta be bold enough to ask. Why? Because you gotta be bold enough to understand that in my asking, I can see it finished. I know what I'm asking for because I can see how I want it to end. Who am I talking to right now? Who am I talking to right now? And I looked up. Good Lord have mercy. And Asia Dose Reese was dying in the hospital. Dying. The night they called me, the death gurgle was in her mouth and she was foaming. All of her organs were shutting down. The doctor said she wasn't going to make it. Cheryl Dose Reese kept saying, well, she asking for you. And every time I got ready to go, the Lord would say no. I said, where's my goddaughter? I ain't been up there to see her. God said no. I said, Lord, why? He said, because you and your emotions. He said, if you go to the hospital today, you're going to judge the circumstance by what you see. I got to get you ready to see what I see. Oh my God, who am I talking to right now? Because some of y'all want to run to the hospital. God wants you to run to prayer. Because sometimes you look at stuff and you start talking about what you see. And God is saying, I'm not talking about your eyesight. I'm talking about your inside. I'm not trying to use your eyesight. I'm trying to use your inside. Come on, somebody. That's why he says, speak those things, but be not as though they were. Who am I talking to? He said, you can't go to the hospital right now. Who am I preaching to tonight? I feel somebody getting healed right now. I said, I feel somebody getting healed right now. He said, wait. He said, no. You can't go to the hospital. I said, okay. I said, okay, God. I can't go to the hospital. He said, you can't go. We went back, 2 weeks went back. Finally, one night, oh, my God, Jesus, have mercy. I was in the church on Long Island preaching on a Tuesday night, teaching on prayer. I was in the church teaching, and that night, I went to step down off the pulpit. And I went to go down the aisle to pray for some people. And my hands twisted up like this. Pastor Soroya was there. And my eyes walled back in my head and I slid down the wall sideways. And my mouth was twisted and I was foaming at the mouth. And she thought that I was having a stroke. And while I was shifting like that and my whole body was shaking, I can hear the Lord saying, Asia, Asia, Asia. And watch this. And while I was shaking like that, the Holy Ghost said to me, take it on. Take it on. And I'm like, and I'm going through these changes. He said, take it on. In other words, take this thing from her body because you're strong enough to dispel it. I'm not hearing y'all. See, y'all playing games in prayer. Nobody got time for no game. If you won't do this thing, you better come on and do it. He said, take this affliction. And I'm still struggling. He said, just like I took your affliction upon myself. Take her affliction. You can wrestle death. You can wrestle death. I shook on that floor until I came to. And when I came to, they had to get me up off the floor and walk me to my car. My whole body was weak. That Sabbath coming up, I'm laying on the couch, and the Holy Ghost said, get up now and go. I got up, got my things, went upstairs, went in my prayer room, got a prayer shawl. He said, wait, get your mustard seed. I had a little case, a little glass case, and inside the glass case was one teeny mustard seed that was glued to the bottom of the case, and it was in a frame. He said, get that. I said, okay. I walked in the hospital, and I walked up to her bed. She was all twisted up, paralyzed. Oh, my God. But before I went, I got to back up. They called me tonight that she was death gurgling. And Cheryl said, is she going to live or die? I said, put the phone to her ear. I said, let me hear her. And she was dying. And I said, and you won't die. And that night, God prophesied to her. I said, not only will you not die, not only are you going to walk, but you're going to run. You're going to run. And I hung the phone up. I didn't stay on the phone no whole lot of conversation. I just hung the phone up. It was after that I had the experience in the church. So when I got there, I walked up to her bed. I said, you see this seed right here? And she nodded. I said, if you got that much, you ain't got to have a whole lot. My God, I feel this for somebody tonight. You ain't got to have a whole lot. All you got to have is enough that's about the size of a mustard seed. I'm not hearing y'all talk back to me. Woo, my God, I just feel the Holy Ghost like, that's all you need is a little bit. No. People got them, listen, people got y'all thinking, I need a whole lot of faith. All you need is a teeny, teeny, teeny. This mountain. Yay. I said, you believe that little bit? She said, yes, ma'am. I said, I believe that little bit. And the Holy Ghost said, now, throw your body across her body. and command this body to line up. Command this body. Gotta back up. I called my sister, who God uses in raising people from the dead. And see, y'all treat prayer like this some church thing. What you talking about? Baby, we is doctors. We is specialists. I'm not here, y'all. I can't get nobody to talk to me. I called my sister. I said, I got a case I need you to help me with. She said, well, what is it? I said, it's this. She ain't walking. She ain't doing this. She twisted up. She said, well, what the Lord said? I said, the Lord said she wasn't going to die. She said, well, just give me 2 days. I said, okay. She put on all white, went in the prayer room for 2 days. She said, I'll call you in 2 days. She came out. She said, go buy some white socks. Tell my mother to put them on. She said, poison is coming out of her feet every single day. For 21 days, she used to change her socks. Every day when they took them socks off, it looked like she had been walking outside in the mud. When she got to the 21st day, Kathy said, now you have contended with death, and I pulled the disease out of her body. She said, now God is about to make her whole. So when I went to the hospital, I didn't go there guessing. I'm not hearing y'all. I didn't go there wondering. I'm not hearing y'all. Because when you do the work in prayer, you can walk in there in confidence. I'm not hearing y'all talk to me. I'm talking to somebody that's watching right now. I don't care what the devil has said. When you do the work in prayer, it's what you say, not what the doctor say. I'm not hearing y'all. I feel divine with vessel in this place. Who am I preaching to right now? It's not what the doctor say. It's what God is saying. Somebody give God a shout in here. God is defying the doctor right now. God is defying the doctor right now. God is defying the doctor right now. You better shout right now. You got a sickness in your body. You better shout right now. You got a disease in your body. I drive it out now. Oh, shut up, I'm on fire. I call your liver to function right. I call your kidney. God, I need a new kidney. God, I need a new kidney. Come on here, you better shout. Somebody better give God a shout. I need a new kidney for my Godfather. I need a new kidney for my Godfather. It ain't the first kidney you've ever done. Function the way God told you to function. I saw my mistake. I see God, I must be made whole. Somebody give God a shout. Sit down for a second. There is seven people in this building tonight. There's seven people in this building tonight that the Lord has given you the gift of healing the sick. He said you better jump up and throw your hands up because God is re-anointing your hands. I speak to the hands in the name of Jesus. Jesus. I speak to the hands. In the name of Jesus, I command the oil of the anointing. I command the oil of the anointing to be upon the palms of your hands. In the name of Jesus, that wherever you lay your hands, they will be made whole. And by his stripes, they are already healed. Somebody give God a shout. This is the last night. This is the last night. This is the last night you're going to see me in a colored dress. It's time to go to work now. Real healing, real deliverance. I see on the Bahia, and under the hooks under the Baha, and the under the hooks under the Baha, and the under the hooks under the Baha. Somebody give God a shout. And only a few months after she came out of the hospital, when she left the hospital, she was still having to stand up with a brace. They were still having to brace her to stand her up. And she said, Godmother, they said I'm going to be paralyzed for the rest of my life. I said, don't tell me nothing else they said. I said, God said, not only are you going to walk, but you're going to run. Oh, Shia. And it wasn't even a year later, my phone dinged. And when it dinged, there was a video on there. And she was on the treadmill running. She said, Godmother, God fulfilled his prophecy. I'm not hearing y'all. I'm not hearing y'all. Oh, I say, the deliverance of the church is in your mouth. The deliverance for your family is in your mouth. The deliverance for your body, for your mind, it is in your mouth. Speak it. Speak it. And so, I remember. They called me and they said that my father had to have his leg amputated up to his knee because my father had diabetes, and the diabetes had got bad, and he had a cut on his foot that wouldn't heal, and it got infected, and after a while the whole leg up to the knee turned green and black. And they went to the doctor, and Sister Pearson, it was stinking, it was smelling up my house. And they said, my father, they had to take the leg. And so I was in a church in revival, and in the hotel room, I was supposed to leave that Saturday. And God said, don't leave. He said, get up and put on all white. Pour some anointing oil in the tub. I want you to take a Holy Ghost bath. I'm going to tell y'all about that. That's when you submerge yourself and you tell God, I want you to anoint me from the top of my head to the sole of my feet. I want you to purify me while I'm in this water. Don't let nothing hinder what you're about to do in me. And he said, take a Holy Ghost bath. And I took a Holy Ghost bath, Dr. Johnson. I got in that tub. I got out. He said, now put on all white and put on white socks. I said, yes, Lord. He said, now I want you to pray. I want you to get some handkerchiefs. And I had to used to carry some handkerchiefs. He said, pray over the handkerchiefs. And I laid on that floor for 24 hours and I prayed. That Sunday, he said, get up. I want you to overnight express this handkerchief to your father. Send it to your sister and tell her, when y'all get to the hospital, give this to daddy. So the handkerchief arrived, Dr. Johnson, that Monday morning. They were supposed to take him in the surgery that Monday morning. And something happened with the doctor. And they didn't take him until Tuesday. I said, God said, turn the handkerchief around his ankle. They tied it around his ankle. And they said, he's going into surgery now. And God, I couldn't sleep all night. My sister called me. She said, it's 7 o'clock. They're rolling him down the hallway now. And I said, but God, you said, oh, my Messiah. I said, God, you said, you told me to do it. And I'm not going to doubt you now because I'm right at the threshold. I'm not going to let Pisgah take me over. This ain't going to be a almost there because my father's foot depends on it. Oh, my Messiah. And they got him in the surgery. And so my father told the doctor, he said, sir, he said, I got one request. And the doctor said, yes. What is it, Mr. Bynum? He said, well, you're not putting me to sleep. He said, well, why? He said, because I'm afraid if I go to sleep, I'm not going to wake up. And he said, you know, most people that stay woke during a surgery, he said, it'll mess with your mind for the rest of your life. And my father said, well, I'll take my chances. He said, but I don't want to go to sleep. He said, well, all right, I won't put you to sleep. He said, I'll leave you woke. He said, I guess you will keep me company. And my daddy said, okay. And so the doctor got ready to do the surgery. He said, do you mind if I turn on some music? And he said, no, sir. He said, I like to listen to this one song. Every time I do surgery, it just keeps me calm. And my father said, okay. And the man stopped playing the music. And it was Psalms 121. And I was on this record singing. My daddy said, that's my daughter singing. He said, your daughter where? He said, on that record. That's my daughter singing that song. He said, you got to be kidding. He said, no, that's my daughter singing. And I was singing, your hand reached into the depths of darkness. Y'all remember that song? And the man said, well, then let's just worship God. And they began to worship God. When the doctor pulled the sheet back, he said, Mr. Bynum, you ain't gonna believe this, but only the tip of your big toe is dark. Your whole leg then came back to color. He walked in the surgery, taking a leg off, and walked out within the tip of his big toe, taking off like a sword. I'm telling you, God can do anything. I'm telling you, there's nothing too hard for God. If you would only believe, if you would only have the faith that the size of a mustard seed, you shall be made whole. My mother, I was in a revival. I don't know why God taking me this way. I was in a revival and my mother got up and went to the bathroom while I was preaching, and something was in the hallway and the floor was messed up at the church, and my mother fell in the hallway. I'm in the middle of preaching and they run to the front of the church while I'm preaching and they said, come here. And I said, well, they said, your mother just got hurt. And I said, hurt how? So the church is there. The service is up. I'm preaching. Holy Ghost said, don't move. I said, bring my mother to me. So they come through the door, and they were carrying my mother. And her ankle, her foot was hanging. She had broke her foot, broke her ankle. It was hanging to the left. And I said, sit my mother on the altar. And they set her down. And I started walking back and forth. And the church was just still. And the Holy Ghost said, take your mother's foot and put it in your stomach. I took her foot and put it in my stomach. And he said, and while you pray and begin to set the ankle back. And I began to move the ankle under the unction of the Holy Ghost. And God set the ankle and I heard it when it snapped. And so by that time the ambulance came. And they said, we're going to take you to the hospital. When they got my mother to the hospital, she was in the emergency room waiting for about 3 hours. When the doctor came in, he said, we're going to get x-rays. What happened? She said, I broke my ankle. He said, oh, okay, we're going to take the x-rays. When the doctor came back, he said, well, what surgeon did you go to? Because they set your ankle back perfect. My mother said, sir, I just broke my ankle about 3 hours ago. He said, no, ma'am. He said, your ankle is set back. I can see where the bone was broken, but the bone unconnected itself back together. She said, Jesus did it. I'm going to tell you all right now. You better understand something, that God is not dead yet. The power to heal is not gone. The power to deliver is not gone. The power of his blood is still alive. Who am I talking to right now? I feel God shooting through the internet tonight. I feel deliverance shooting through the internet tonight. I give a Lord saying, be made.
of your people. Somebody give God a shout.
Your loins, arise and tell them all that I command you. Do not be dismayed and break down at the sight of their faces, lest I confound you before them and permit you to be overcome. For I, behold, I have made you this day. He's talking to everybody in this room. He's talking to everybody that's watching by internet. For behold, I have made you this day a fortified city. You ain't gonna break down. I don't hear nobody. And an iron pillar, you're not gonna be moved. And bronze walls, ain't nobody, nothing gonna be able to break through. You better hear God tonight. Against the whole land, against the successive kings of Judah, against its princes, against its priests, and against the people of the land, giving you divine strength, which no hostile power can overcome you. Who am I talking to? Tonight, the Lord gives you divine strength. Somebody give God a shout. Tonight, the Lord gives you divine strength. Dresses. It's time for all white. It's time to go to work now. I'm not here, y'all. I can't hear nobody talk to me. It's time to go to work now. I'm not hearing nobody here. I said it over here. He said, you done taught enough. You done taught enough. It's time to go to work now. He can't another motion. It's here for the Mashike Baba. He showed up on the Amoshike Baba. Somebody give God a praise up here. Tonight I give you divine strength. Tonight I give you divine strength. Tonight I give you divine strength. I give you a strength that you know not of. I release a power in you that you know not of. This is a victory that you didn't see coming. And you shall not be moved. And you shall not be shaken. And you shall not be weary. But the Lord strengthens your enemy. But the Lord tonight, he strengthens your enemy. Somebody give God a shout. Book of Exodus, the 39th chapter. It says, and God gave Moses, watch this, to finish the tabernacle and the altar. You didn't hear that. So I ask a question tonight. What would have happened if Moses had not finished the tabernacle and the altar? We today would not have a clear understanding of the fact that we are the temple of the Lord. Do you see that? If he had not finished that work, then your understanding of you being a tabernacle and God needs the altar of your heart, it wouldn't be clear. I'm not hearing y'all. I'm not hearing y'all. Who am I talking to right now? Who am I talking to, saints? Who am I talking to? If John the Baptist had not finished and became beheaded, we wouldn't have the understanding that to please God, sometimes you gotta suffer something. I'm not hearing y'all. I need somebody in this building tonight. I need somebody that's watching my internet to start praising God for the anointing of the finished work. Hey, who's sick? Oh, I said, I need somebody in here to praise God. Y'all sitting there, but I need somebody to praise God. Lord, birth that thing in me. Lord, birth it in me to finish. Lord, birth the anointing to finish in me. God, birth it in me. God, I keep breaking down at the halfway point. God, I keep getting to a certain point, and then I go back to bad habits, and I go back to bad habits. But God, this time, let me be sure-footed. This time, get me to finish. Help me tonight to finish my course with joy. Somebody ask God for it. Now begin to praise Him. Now begin to praise Him. You gotta finish. The devil wants you to quit now. You can't quit. You gotta finish. Too much. He don't want you to finish because somebody else's completion is in your finish. He don't want you to finish because somebody's healing is in your finish work.
He's rebuking us for starting the business and then laying it down, halfway doing it and not finishing. I'm not hearing nobody talk to me. Oh God, He's rebuking us for having gifts and talents, but we have not gone on to perfect what God has given us. Who is the Lord rebuking it here? If you receive it, God will usher you to the finished work.
God, I feel the Holy Ghost in here. I feel the presence of the Lord in each of you. I feel the presence of the Lord in here. What you don't understand is the little things. It's the little things. If I give you to sweep the floor, sweep until you don't see nothing else. A finished work. If I give you to run the bookstore, run it with everything you got. A finished work. If I give you to work the sound room, work it with everything you got or get away from it. It's a finished work. Clean up everything around it. Perfect it. Or I can't finish nothing in none of y'all. You can't perfect what's in my house. I can't perfect what's in yours. If I call you to be a deacon, be it with all of your might. Don't come to church some Sundays with a t-shirt on and the next Sunday you got a tie on. Be consistent. Be an example. If I call you to dance, start dancing. Whatever I call you to do, it's not finished. Get back on the dance floor. Get back in another class and take another class and another class and another class, Ingrid, and another class and another class. I'm not finished. It's not perfect. But I'm going to tell you what the enemy is to a finished work. The enemy to a finished work. Do anybody want to know what it is? It's simple. The greatest enemy to the hindrance of a finished work is a compliment. Compliment is a killer. It's a compliment. Oh, I really enjoyed all your books, Dr. Barnum. It's a compliment. I didn't give you three that you ain't finished. See, I'm not going to stand on the floor and lie. I didn't give you three books that you haven't finished. All your homework is done, but you're too busy. Don't get caught up in your last success when you're failing in this one. Some of us is gonna let people compliment you right out of the will of God. Gonna let people compliment me right out the will of God. Got my little check, my little royalty check, Dr. Morgan. Dr. Morgan, there's a book in you. There's a book in you. God wants you to finish it. There's a book in you. It's going to bless lives like never before. There's a sometimes we don't understand why God will cause things to shut down. We don't understand why the pipes is breaking. We don't understand why it's taking so long, because the Lord has given some of us time to finish the work. I saw you sitting on television. I saw you sitting on television just then, talking about your book. I saw you traveling. I saw you being invited to leadership conferences. God said, finish the book. Finish the book. Dr. Johnson, this book has been in you, I know, for 10 years, and I'm going to tell you what it is. The power of perception, I never forgot. The power of perception. I remember upstairs you talking to me, and you said that people can get the revelation about perception. It'll change lives. The Lord said, finish it. My God, I hear the Lord in here. 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 I give 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 the Lord in here. Because some of y'all, oh my God, I give the Holy Ghost said that some of you all in this building, you under the seduction of the victim. You love to be a victim. And God said, I break that spirit off of you right now. You want to be a victim. You want to keep talking about what you lost. You want to keep talking about what you used to have. And God said, get out of it and get to work and do what I called you to do and finish the work. That is gone. It is not coming back. Stop mourning who you used to be and finish what I have given you now. Stop me now, but a storm. Hey. And here comes the storm. Had my ticket, and the airline shut down and canceled 3,000 flights. And I came upstairs and I said, God, I was really looking forward to going. Why I can't go? And he said, watch this. Go back downstairs. I came back down here. I know he RJ, but I call him AJ. I said, get that tape and start taping these cords down. He said, this is why you can't go to Africa. Because you can't leave an unfinished work. Okay, I'm done. The curtain still ain't on the wall right. How you going all up in Africa preaching? The curtains. Oh, that don't matter. But what was going to happen? I understand it. I was going to Africa to preach. But they wouldn't have got a full work. Because it's coming out of a vessel that's left the unfinished work. You can only bring people to a partial deliverance as long as what the Lord has called you to do is unfinished. So I got my spirit right and I came on back down here. And I said, take these cords up. I said, baby, what's the name? I said, baby, get that cloth and put that all around that right there. Yeah, move all that stuff out that corner. Move all that stuff out this corner. Put Lady Morgan's name on her chair back there and her bag. Get all these bags. Who bags is these? Throw them bags up on that table. Get all these cords up. Push them cords up somewhere. Put the drum thing up. Mic the drums. I was working like I was the pastor. But the Holy Ghost said, I called you to be a part of this body. And as long as this is unfinished, I can't finish what you want me to do for you. Because if this is my house and your body is the house, if this is my temple and your body is the temple, how you gonna not finish one temple and want me to complete another? Today, and I think everybody was mad at me. Everybody was mad at me. It was rolling eyes and everything. No, because I keep hearing them say, finish. And Pastor was talking about that. I said, he said, finish. I said, "The pastor, let's take it down." I said, because the illusion in the body of Christ is they think everything is hocus pocus. It just happens. No. People need to see that something ain't finished, but I'm standing on the promise of God because I know what I've seen in my spirit's eye. Oh, somebody better lift your hands up right now. Somebody better lift your hands up right now. Somebody better lift your hands up right now. Oh, Corey, y'all come here. Yes, Lord. I need some men. Come here. Move this curtain. Move this curtain. Come on. Move all that out the way, because you need to understand tonight. You need to understand tonight that watch this, that when you got a vision, you can't get discouraged about what you see. I'm not giving y'all, because you know what? We trying to impress people. Come on, somebody. You got, oh God, you got to keep rejoicing. You got to keep rejoicing. That's right. He tearing down pride. That curtain right there, pride coming down. He tearing down pride. You don't care what people think. Here, somebody, I see the finished work in my eyes. Somebody give God a praise. Somebody give God a praise. You better praise Him. It does not yet appear what we shall be. Oh, you better praise Him. Anybody got a vision? You better praise Him. Anybody got a vision? You better praise Him. Turn around and touch three people and say, "I'm gonna finish. I'm gonna finish." Turn around and touch three people and say, "I'm gonna finish." Somebody, come on here, somebody. You better give God a praise. what God is saying? Your stage is a part of somebody else's life's finish. You better give God a praise for that. Your stage is a part of somebody else's finish. You can't quit.
God,
give me the power to finish. God, I don't care, Lord, if I'm making a bowl of soup, just give me the power to finish. I want this message to get in the fibers of everybody in this building, everybody that's watching. God, just give me the power to finish. He told me to open a music school. God, give me the power to finish. Give me the power, Lord, to write the curriculum. Give me the power, Lord, to write the book that is in me. Give me the power, Lord. You done gave me a burden for mothers and daughters. Give me the power to do it. Lord, give me the power so I can stop dreaming. Hold on, Messiah. Come on, wake up, wake up, wake up, wake up. Lord, wake us up, because we're dreaming. We keep dreaming good ideas and big ideas, but we're letting grass grow under our feet because we're not finishing. Oh, are you hearing me? Are you hearing me? He didn't give you a dream so you can be happy. He gave you a dream because he wants you to finish what he has shown you.
I gotta finish. I gotta work for the next few days on my books. I'm behind schedule. God, I don't have to see today. I done did all the research, all the notes, all the papers organized. And we become satisfied with the prep work. Yes. We become satisfied, Dr. Morgan, with the prep work, and God wants the product. Yeah. Finish. You don't even know what God is doing. Why would the Lord allow the pipes to break next door? Watch this. And then open the door for me to go on national television. And this is the only spot in the whole church that Pastor Nim can give me to build the stage, a set that's getting ready to be televised to the world. And then the pipes break and we got to come in here and have church so that God can birth an anointing in here, because that anointing is going to the nations. So can you imagine if we didn't finish? Oh, you better get God a prayer. I'm telling you it's a divine connection. I'm telling you, the devil wants you to quit. He wants you to quit in the middle of what God has given you, because he's afraid that if you finish, there are some things attached to it that is going to blow your mind. The devil himself do not want you to finish. I'm not satisfied with a lighting chest. I want some lights. I'm not satisfied with planks. I want some carpet. Why am I building this stage? Because in another city, there's a set being built that's going to have to sit on the foundation. But on the 14th, when the set people come, how sad would it be if Deacon Robertson said, "I'm sorry, I got tired and I didn't finish," what would they sit it on?
Come on, finish it.
What if little baby that's painting said, "I'm tired of painting. I ain't painting no more." It wouldn't be ready for TV. He can't set a $60,000 plus set on a foundation
that somebody got an attitude and said, I don't feel like finishing. Because one thing depends upon another. Because your life is interdependent. Whatever's going on in you is connected to me. Whatever's going on in me is connected to you. Whatever's going on in y'all is connected to me. God has put me over this page. He's put me over this page. He's put me over at three with me. Whatever's going on with y'all on this page is going on with me, because we're interdependent. I'm depending on you all to keep growing, and God is depending on me to keep teaching. Are you hearing this? Are you hearing this? Now you praise God, because you are a part of somebody else's divine connection. Your finishing is a part of somebody else's work. What do you mean you're not going to pray? What do you mean you're not going to pray through? All over this building, my God. Whew, tonight has blessed your life. Go to that contact button. Go up there to that contact us button and sow your 121. I ain't even pushing it. If tonight has blessed your life, you sow that $21 seed, or you sow 121. But you sow into the finished work. That's what you're sowing into tonight. Give me some envelopes all over this building. All over this building.